Thanks for being with us on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we are very fortunate to have with us Michaela Martens, American mezzo-soprano.
Good to have you here.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
You play a lot of very strong ladies in your opera roles, such as Marilyn Klinghoffer, Kolchtanichka, Clytemnestra, and Susan B. Anthony. Now, I want to know where this all comes from. When you were a young child, were you a strong, strong child?
Very, yeah, very. And I'm a middle child. But yeah, I was a very opinionated child, but I was also a tomboy. I played all the way from as far back as I can remember until my sophomore year of college. I played two sports, volleyball and baseball. So it started as baseball and then it went into softball, but I was a really strong little girl.
Where did you grow up?
Seattle, Washington.
Seattle.
Yeah.
How did you start it? I mean, you know, when you were young, you already know that you want to be a singer?
I did. According to my parents, I knew when I was five and I made a big announcement that, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? And my answer was always, I want to be an opera singer. But I couldn't really carry a tune until I was about 14. And so I danced as a... My father and mother were both musicians. My dad was a tenor. My mother was a soprano. So I grew up hearing this. And grandparents are singers. Everybody in my family is a singer.
What kind of singing? Classical or just?
My mother's side is classical, and my father's side was all big band musicians. So they had a band on Friday and Saturday night.
So what did they think?
They loved it. My grandparents were so proud of me, but my grandfather would have preferred if I'd been, you know, Helen Whiting, or, you know, if I'd gone the big band route and been Ruby Keeler, it would have meant better. But I didn't have the voice for it. I had the voice for this.
Mm-hmm. So when did you start taking lessons?
When I was 14. And my mom took me out to sing with a wonderful teacher at the University of Washington, who's no longer with us, but she was a fantastic teacher. And I had a couple lessons with her. I'd go out to the university once a week and have a lesson. And then I was a teenager, so I did a lot of musical theater. And my dad was a big influence there because he was a director too, and so...
Then it came time for college.
Yep.
So you wanted to go somewhere with a strong vocal department.
I did. And I went to the University of Washington to start. They had a fantastic facility, but I just wanted... It was a state school, so on top of music classes, I was also taking fisheries and history classes, which I loved, but I wanted to just be, in it the whole time. And so I came out to New York and met Ellen Fall, who I studied with privately for 3 years, and then she sent me to Juilliard.
Mm-hmm. Were you entering competitions by this time? Or?
I did. The first, I didn't have any experience with competitions. I didn't know anything about it. So she thought it would be a great experience for me to enter the Met competition. And so, because there were several stages, and it seemed kind of benign to do one little bit, and then if you didn't win, oh, well, you did a competition. And I kept going. And I got all the way to...
The finals.
The finals on the stage at the Metropolitan Opera House. And at that time, they pull you back in that little room, the guild room, and my name was announced, eight people, and I was one of them. And I'd never sung with a symphony orchestra before. And so my first symphony to sing with was the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra, and Sir Charles McCarris was conducting. And I remember Ellen Fall's face when my name was announced, and I looked at her and I go, "What now?" And she goes, "I don't know." But that was my very first symphony orchestra.
What did you sing that very first time?
I sang the Balatella and the Jewel Song, because this is my soprano days. So I sang.
How was the feeling when you were on stage?
Absolutely thrilling. And Joan Dorneman was our prompter at the time. And I move a lot when I sing, and I wander around and flail my arms, and I'm very active, and that didn't seem to work so well. And so everybody kept trying to tell me to stand still, and I was standing still, and I couldn't sing. I felt like I was in a straitjacket. And we were in the Zitzprobe, and Sir Charles was conducting, and Joan Dornaman came running up to me and she said, I have a message for you. And I said, yes, yes, as they're playing the entrance to the Balotella. Yes. She said, Gail Robinson says, move. So I danced all over the thing. That was my freedom, you know. So that, at the end of the concert, Joan and I were beside ourselves happy because it's that feeling of that orchestra, you know.
Did you get nervous at all?
Terrified.
Yes.
Terrified. Yeah, but then once you're in it and you're going, you don't have a choice. I mean, you're on that stage and there's 4,000 seats in front of you. I mean, you have to keep going. But yeah, I was terrified.
What did happen after that?
After I won, I was very inexperienced. So I went home and I said to Ellen, what do we do? She said, you got to go back to school. So I actually won the Met competition and then went back to school. And that's when I went to Juilliard. I won in 1992 and I started Juilliard in 94. And I went and I took acting classes and language classes and movement and diction. It was extraordinary. So for me, that was the correct order of things. It would have been disastrous if I had just jumped straight into the Met program or something. And Gail Robinson knew that.
Mm-hmm. How long did you stay at Juilliard?
2 years. Two fantastic, amazing years. I loved every second of it. I loved walking in those halls. One time I got on an elevator, and sitting in the back of the elevator was Itzhak Perlman. I got on, and somebody screamed, hold the elevator, and it was Dmitry Fodostovsky who came running on, and I thought, I can't, I don't even know what to do. But it was great. I loved it.
Speaking of these stars and legends, which singers were there ones that you idolized when you were young and just starting to sing?
Yeah. I idolized every single note of Leontine Price. Every single thing she sang, I loved. But and as I started to study, I discovered other singers. Tatiana Troyanos was and is the sound in my ears. But I think if I had to pick one female singer, the one I am so moved by was Lorraine Hunt Lieberson. What an artist. Everything she sings and sang, you don't have to see it to feel it with her. It's just stunning.
Just touch you.
Oh, my. Yeah, I saw her sing Didon at the Met, mm-hmm. and I thought I'll never hear it that way again.
Have you ever sung Didon?
No, I did Cassandra, uh-huh. but not Didon. Mm-hmm.
So after 2 years, did you know that where you're going?
I did, because I, halfway through my first year, I met a manager who then kind of put his hand on me and said, I've got this. And so by the time I finished my time at Juilliard, which was 1996, I had two seasons booked out. It was unexpectedly challenging. That the whole life of it, singing and learning, traveling all the time, putting yourself on that sort of high profile stage, because the contracts were with the Met, with Maestro Ozawa, and so it was a big couple of years. But yeah, I did know where I was going, but I had a lot of guidance.
It was a good 2 years in the first 2 years?
Hard. Very, hard. Very, very, very hard. Yeah, and I got pretty burnt out.
Were you still a soprano at this point?
I was.
When did the change come?
After my second baby.
Aha. Uh-huh.
How so?
I had the kids, and I was still sort of flirting around with the idea that I wasn't quite happy up on the extremes. And then I had the kids, and hormonally, something just happened to my body, and I gained 3 notes on the bottom and 3 notes on the top, but my comfort zone shifted to the center. Mm-hmm. And it was... I wasn't so willing to sit up in the stratosphere, and I really, really felt comfortable in the middle and the bottom.
Was that a crisis? Do you think, oh, my God, what's happening?
Yes, only because at that time, my teacher, who's still my teacher, Ruth Falcon, said, I can't do this. I'm in the middle of a thing here. I'm a soprano. And you don't just switch. Like,
you have contracts.
She said, well, you kind of do. Mm-hmm. So... I started in a really quick way with the very basics, with the 24 Italian art songs and arias and vacai. And I went to, you know, Kefaro and all these different things, and ended up.
What did you do? You already had this, you know, soprano contract.
I took some Zwischenfach things. I took things that aren't so high. I did unusual repertoire. I sang Miss Jessel in Turn of the Screw. I did things that weren't going to be Desdemona in Otello, you know. So I did that way. But my big problem was that, you know, these big soprano parts, you bow last, right? So and in my head, I'm used to this kind of thing. And I said to Ruth, I said, I don't even know how to do that. And she goes, you're not going to bow. She was really patient with me. But she helped me understand that you can't change it. You are what you are. So, and I always, you and I have worked together, and I've always liked to sing in the middle, and I always like to mark down the octave. And so it was a natural fit, but it was jarring for my career.
But yet you say you're comfortable in the middle, but the top is very, very good.
Yeah.
You didn't lose the top.
No.
By working your way down.
No, but I think it's where you're, when you concentrate your body and you're lined up in the right way, those notes all of a sudden felt so much easier for me than they did as a soprano. And it was a really, really natural progression to go from singing mezzo to singing these big heroic mezzo parts. And the only difference in the tessitura is the intention of the character. So Kostelnichka is just as high as Yenufa, but she sings in a different emotional approach.
Do you think the transition is smooth one emotionally?
Mm-hmm, very. Yeah, because the thing that bored me about being a soprano, and I respect you all who do it, but the thing that I couldn't do was sit in a recliner and sing. Or waft from place to place and then sing. I didn't understand the women. These women I understand. These big emotional heights mm-hmm. and these low, low, low depths. Those women I understand. I just didn't understand the Countess and Fiordaligi, and I didn't understand them. Mm-hmm. So.
Did you have to actually cancel contracts for the soprano contracts?
I did. I can't remember what they were, but I do remember getting out of a couple of them. And fortunately, my management at the time was pretty understanding.
So you actually took some time off where you didn't do any singing or did?
Yeah,
yeah.
I did.
How long was that?
I took off a decent amount of time, actually, for this transition, also because I had my two kids. Mm-hmm. I took a 2 years off for the birth of my son and then a year off for the birth of my daughter. And it was a good time to also do work on this transition. And also just prior to that, my husband had a very bad car accident. And so I didn't feel so comfortable leaving the city. And so we kind of stuck close. And I went to work at Goldman Sachs. So I did.
How did that happen?
I needed to keep working and earn a living. And I.
But why can't you just continue to sing?
It was a lot. This transition was a lot. And also the kids, handling the kids, and I needed to be able to temp, and I didn't want to be gone. You know, singing, it takes you away for 5 weeks, 6 weeks at a time, and I had at first one little person and then two little people, so I went and temped at Goldman Sachs, and they were fantastic, and I ultimately became a full-time employee at Goldman Sachs.
What were you thinking? You thinking, okay. Maybe I'm just going to change my profession?
I actually didn't think that far in advance, mostly because I thought, I'm happy enough doing this, and I took my lunch hours and I practiced at a local studio down on Wall Street. Mm-hmm. So I was still doing things, and once a year I would take my vacation time and I'd go sing somewhere. I got 3 weeks paid vacation, so I'd go sing something somewhere. But then Maestro Zawa intervened. I was a full-time employee at Goldman Sachs, and he called and said, we're doing Peter Grimes and Saito Kinin, and we can't do it without you. So I quit my job,
yeah.
And I went to work with him.
So the rest of the history.
Yeah, yeah. If I hadn't done that, I probably, chances are very good I'd still be at Goldman Sachs in private equity, but you know, he jumped in and saved me.
Well, that's great. And what came after that?
after I had the kids, we hit our stride as a family, you know, with the traveling and all of that, and the kids, and Andrew stayed home with them while I would travel. But the thing that happened was, Lenore Rosenberg hired me to do things at the Metropolitan, and that was perfect. I was a working mom. I was home with the kids in the morning. I could get to them if I needed to. Sometimes they came to rehearsal. I remember they came to one Valkyrie rehearsal that we had in the house. And so it was perfect. And I spent probably the first few years back as a mezzo doing small things in the house. And oftentimes it was like I think the first 2 or 3 years I was on contract for 9 months. So I was this working mom.
What was your debut at the Met?
The aunt in Yanufa.
Aunt.
Jezusi Kriste, taku tatile tvoje dite. That's my whole part.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure you did it very well. But then you covered some big roles.
I did.
And you had what was your first big moment of jumping in?
My first jump in there was Parsifal. That was my first big jump in.
You're talking Kundry?
Yeah. I had done things. The Second Norn, I had done the Countess de Coigny, but my first big thing was jumping in.
How much notice?
When I had to sing, I sang two rehearsals. Maestro Gatti was in the pit. I had exactly the time it took me to set my tea down to run upstairs and get on the stage. It was that much. And then I was on a field trip with my daughter. And Sissy Strauss called and said, Michaela, if you want it, the show is yours for tonight. I had about 5 hours notice. And so I drove from my house, which is 2 hours north of here, drove straight in, parked the car, went and met the stage directors, hair and makeup, and on stage. I didn't even have time to think about being nervous.
No time to get nervous.
None. In that big production with, you know, with Jonas Kaufmann and René Pape, it was surreal but fantastic.
So were you, say, okay, I can do this all the time?
Yeah. And you're jumping in when you're not prepared mentally to have to do it. You really don't think about it because it's your responsibility. It's your job. You have to get out there and you have to do a good job. But I had this other thing on the other side, which was I had to finish the show and drive immediately home because I had these two little kids. I had a second grader and a fourth grader to get to school the next morning. So I jumped in this big thing and everybody was out celebrating and I got a call from the prompter and she said, where are you? I said, I'm on the road home. I got, you know, kids to get out the door in the morning. So, but after that, the more responsibilities from the Met came, mm-hmm. bigger contracts from them came, bigger contracts around the world came.
So, but the dealing with the family still was there of being away and being home, even though the kids were getting older, but still.
Yeah.
You needed to be there. Do they ever travel with you?
Sometimes they come. They come to what they call the fun places. They came to Santa Fe. So that's one of the fun places. Then they'll come to San Francisco next time I'm there. They've been to London, another fun place. And they come and they just hit the streets being a tourist. Places like Zurich, when I go there, it's easy because kids can wander around by themselves and they're perfectly safe to do so. So, yeah, they've been to Graz and they've been to Vienna.
Do they really understand what you do?
They've seen everything, yeah. Uh-huh. And now they're getting opinions. And so they've seen all of the
things. What would they say to you?
My son told me when we were in Graz, I was doing Ortrud and Lohengrin, and he came out of a rehearsal, and I said, how was that, buddy? And he said, it was good. I could use more consonants, but it was good.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's funny. Do they, either one of them want to sing, or do they sing at all?
My daughter does, yeah. Uh-huh. My daughter sings. My son's a trumpet player, and he wants to be Maynard Ferguson, but he's a trumpet player.
You think she's going to go that way?
I do.
Oh, really?
I do. She's uh-huh. the loudest child ever.
Soprano, another soprano.
A mezzo. Right now she is.
So, and what else happened to you after all these changes?
The first time I took a really big part that was my own was Kostelnička, and that's from the guys at ENO who had so much faith and were so so brave with giving me big things. So that was the first big responsibility, and that was also the first step in singing for such long periods of time. You know, there's a certain map that you need when you do these big giant parts, and you have to learn what that is and how much you can sing all the time and how much you need to hold back. And but it, laying the bricks for singing these big long histrionic parts, you know, that was an important piece of information. Otherwise, you just wear out halfway through the opera, which you can't do. You know.
Mm-hmm. So it was in English at the ENO.
Yeah. Everything's in English there.
Right. Have you done that other places in Czech?
Yeah. I did it in Zurich twice, in Czech, and at ENO, both times in English.
You know, for the situation, a lot of singers, when they stop, when they're doing something else, I think they are in crisis. Mm-hmm. They might not have a chance like you have.
Yeah.
So what would you say, what do you do? I mean, when you have this confusion situation, right. Are you going to have your career or you're not?
You're going to do both. Christine Gerke and I have talked a long time about this very thing, because we talk about when you have a sick child, what do you do? Like, do you cuddle the sick child, or do you, you know, give him to the nanny or your husband or whatever? And we both agree, you cuddle the sick child, because at the end of the day, this thing, as much as you love it and as much as you really... half of your life is built on that stage and what you do and what you create. It is your job. And these kids are, you know, ultimately they're the people I'm going to be looking at when I'm 75 years old. And I want them to be healthy and happy and know that I was there all the time. And so you do the kids, you build your life, and then you have your beautiful job. It's a great job, but it's a job. Yeah.
So you are in peace with your
Very
career
much
right
so.
Now.
Yeah. Oh yeah, yeah. I've sung on some of the best stages in the world with some of the best conductors and the best musicians, and in terms of a bucket list, there's nothing on my bucket list. Mm. You know, now everything else is just for me and joy, mm-hmm. and because you get to do it. But you know, I've sung with some of the greatest musicians in the world, with some of the greatest singers in the world, the greatest orchestras.
But there still must be some operas that you have, or some roles in great operas you haven't done yet, that you still have on some kind of a list, no?
Yep. I want to do the whole Berlioz, the whole Les Troyens. I want to do the whole thing, both parts.
Both parts, not in the same evening.
Yes.
You do.
I do.
You're one of those.
I am one of those.
Yes, no limits.
That's, I do.
It's of course it's been done, but it's not an easy
feat. It's a long night on your feet.
Yeah. But, you trying to do that?
I do. I would love to do that. If I had a chance to go and do it again, I would love to try and do Desdemona again. Knowing what I know now, I would love to do the Marshalin again. Knowing what I know now as a person, I would love to go back and try that again.
Why not?
Why not? Just find somebody who will let me do it again.
That sounds very possible. Unfortunately, we need to take a break, but okay. We're here with Michaela Martens on Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. We'll be right back.